And now, the way it used to be, here's Joey.
Friday, October 2nd. Do you love the October feel? You know, I like the, you know, I'm a Midwest guy. I like the October vibe that happens, right? You know, pumpkin pie, I don't know, the leaves falling, everything else. The bottom line is, my friends, I'm here with a very special, I love to call it, because they're new friends. They mean a lot to me. Okay, my good friend here to my right, I didn't let you know who it was going to be because it was a surprise, all right? Miss Elizabeth Jones, the lovely wife and widow of a guy that I admired very much, Deacon Jones. Elizabeth, I want to welcome you to the Joey Ciccone Show, the way it used to be.
Thank you very much for having me, Joey. It's really a pleasure being here. And
she's so sweet. I get excited.
You're a funny guy.
Yeah, funny how? Funny how? What?
We'll get into that later.
We're getting into that later, all right? All right, and I just want to say her sister's here, too, and which is off camera, but I love that because it brings the energy up and everything's beautiful. And before we get started, because, you know, I always like to be honest. You know, I never want to tell stories. There's a lot of traffic out there today. John, is my collar, it's okay, everything's good? Looking good? My makeup, it's all right.
Good.
Beautiful, babe. A lot of traffic.
You look marvelous.
You look marvelous, darling.
Got messed up in the traffic, his collar. Right?
Marvelous. I was worried when I was in the traffic. I was like, a lot of traffic out there for all my friends listening Friday. Be safe. A lot of accidents. And I just want you to be safe. But the bottom line is this. Coming off of the clip that you just saw that we put together special, not just for Elizabeth, but for Deacon and the things he's done. You know, talk is cheap. A lot of people do a lot of talking. But when it's from the heart and that you feel that it's from the heart, of course, I happen to be Italian and we're very emotional gentlemen at times. And then sometimes we dig holes. That's where I actually was before I came here.
That's why I had a lot of traffic.
Yeah, that's why. That's why I was running a little late. So we had to. It's all beautiful. The guys are here. I'm very excited. I want to jump right into it. First of all, I want to do this. You saw that opening clip?
I didn't see the clip. I heard it.
Well, you heard it, but you will see it now when we go to video. You're going to see everything.
Okay, good.
And I think you like it, but you might have seen it. I think that was off of the NFL site or something that we got.
Okay. Yeah, I think I've seen every clip available more than once.
Now, is this your water and your
your
cherry lemonade mixture?
Whatever, yes.
It's a California thing. Anyway, the bottom line is I want to start by showing you the love for you to be here, because we met at an event, my friends, and you meet a lot of people at events, and to have Elizabeth here on my show, which is, as you remember, the way it used to be, which basically covers a lot of things, not just Vegas, not just Hollywood, not just books, not just wise guys, but it covers sports guys and the way things used to be from how they are today, and we're going to cover it till 6 o'clock, all right? Then we go to dinner and everything's beautiful. But darling, I wanted you to have that. That's from the heart. That was taken by a very close friend of mine. I've given him a lot of plugs there. The name's in the right-hand corner. And until he sends a check, we will not say his name.
I wouldn't repeat it.
Ira, thank you. I love you, okay?
This is a great photo. I love this, Joey. Thank you.
Thank you, sweetie. And that's Miles Davis's trumpet that was given to me when I was signed with him at the age of 22 out of Chicago, Illinois. And it's an honor to have that trumpet, and it means the world to me, and it's a great picture, and we got to get you over here, man, because we got to talk to you, but now we're going to start. We're going to talk a little bit.
Okay, sure.
I know you didn't see the clip, and it was on there, but like me and you talked this week, we kind of kept it open, because what I love is not to have questions that are all set up for you or you can have the answers, you know, ready for me and everything. It's that spontaneous wonderful feeling of just making it happen while we're on the air, while we're on the radio. So all my friends out there, I want to say something very clearly right now, okay? I'm here with Elizabeth Jones with the Deacon Jones Foundation. They do the most incredible things. I was there for 2-3 hours listening to this lady speak, and I was impressed, and for me to be impressed, that's why she is here. But then again, she gave me the opportunity to come here and be with me when she could have sat anywhere with anybody. I want to give you the number right off the bat. It's 702-483-4444. We'll take some questions today. We got a lot to cover. We're going to talk about a lot of great things. But like I told Elizabeth on an email, today's about you and today's about Deacon. And we want to find out everything. So if I don't say much, which could be kind of hard, but we're going to have you do a lot of the speaking, darling.
I don't care, but 2 hours is, you know, not enough.
2 hours
to
is
say
nothing,
everything.
Honey. It can't be, darling. I understand that. So that one's going to be for you. And then what we want to talk about, I want to just get into some things.
Please.
Let's start just, we saw a little bit of his career. I mean, I used to love growing up and watching the Sack Man, the man that made the name. And you guys know who I'm talking about, all right? L.A. Rams, okay? All right? The Redskins, okay? The bottom line is the man took care of business, okay? And we're going to be talking about that today. So we want to start off kind of easy because you're going to be with me for a little bit. How'd you meet? It's always a good question, right?
Yeah, it's a good question. And I always want to make up a story that's, you know, kind of exciting.
Yeah, lie and make up a good one, like a Hollywood story. Just
like,
lie.
You know, on the ski slopes of Aspen. The only time, one problem is every time I said that, Deacon was scared to death of heights. So
I am too. I don't,
are you?
Oh,
yeah.
I don't like him.
Yeah, he hated it. No, we met through a mutual friend.
Through a mutual
friend?
Nothing
very exciting.
And when was that offhand? When was that?
1982,
right. Mm-hmm. We've seen some, because we do research, you know, for the show. So we've seen some wonderful pictures and some great things. So the year was 1982, and obviously you met and you started a relationship, and he was already doing his thing, am I right?
He was already retired and in the Hall of Fame, yes.
Taking care of business. If you caught that. The Hall of Fame, okay?
The Pro Football Hall of Fame and about 20 other Halls of Fame.
Yes. Speak of them if you'd like, because I want to open it up to you now.
Oh, I don't. I mean, they're all over the place. The South Carolina Hall of Fame, the Mississippi Hall of Fame, the California Sports Hall of Fame, the... I don't know. The only one that's really important, unfortunately, is the Pro Football Hall of Fame, right?
That's all that matters. The NFL, that's what it's about.
Right, exactly.
And he took care of business, and that's what we love. So we want to do is I had some questions set up for you where, you know, I'd like to ask you some things.
Please.
And your lovely sister is here, and where is she from?
We're both from Hollywood, California, USA.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right. I like that. Nice.
Yeah, you like that?
Why? Because I lived there for 25 years. Where did I live? Well, it started out in Hollywood in 1988. It was a little bungalow. Then we went to Studio City. Then we climbed up to Encino by Michael Jackson's house. It was nice.
I lived up there, too.
Yeah, you know where I'm talking about?
Yeah, I lived in Royal Oaks.
Please, yes. A little bit too much. Is this suit all right that I'm
wearing? No, not quite.
Not quite. Nice. She attacks me. Good. All right.
You
the Armani
it up
suit.
By, hey, what can
that's
I
all
say?
Right. Okay, no, that's good. Now everything's up for grabs.
Yeah.
All right, so the bottom line is lived in Encino, had a wonderful time, left in 2004. And so you're L.A. Girls.
Yes.
I got a song called L.A. Girl. I think we're playing it today, aren't we? Possibly, maybe. We're going to see if we have that. If not, you're going to get the album. We're going to talk about that.
Well, see, I didn't know my husband when he played, but being an L.A. girl, he was my idol. He was the Rams, you know.
To me, you know, there's everybody talks and everything else, but to me, he was. And
yeah, he was.
And I sat there, and my friends know me, and my fans know me from the heart. I sat there and watched clip after clip after clip of quarterbacks going down left and right. That's part of the story of what he did on the field. Then there's a whole part of what he did off the field as a humanitarian, as I am myself. And we have so much to talk about, and we got a lot of questions. So happy you're here. Your lovely sister's
Thank
name
you,
is what?
My dear Ellen.
Ellen, and you're are you in the Anaheim area or just around there or what? You're on the Orange County show, aren't you?
She lives in Las Vegas. That's why I moved here.
Oh, you live here, darling. Where do you live? Spanish Trails? How did I know that? How did I know that? Listen, you're with Joey Ciccone. I'm going to take a little break. I'm coming back with my good friend, Elizabeth Jones, the wife of the famous Deacon Jones, and the lovely sister from Las Vegas. We'll be right back.
Bless me. Bless me mucho. Each time I cling to your lips, the music divine. Bless me mucho. Love me, my darling, and say that you'll always be mine. Joy is something new, my arms enfolding you. Never knew this thrill before. Whoever thought I'd be holding you close to me, whispering, hey, you I adore. Dearest one, if you should leave me, each little dream would take wing, and my life would be through. Bésame, 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 bésame mucho. Love me, my darling, mate. All my dreams come true. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Cocho on the piano. Give it up for him, please. Bésame mucho. Each time I cling to your lips, hear music divine. Bésame mucho. Love me, my darling, and say you'll always be mine. Thank you.
John Goldman on the trumpet, ladies and gentlemen. Darling, and say you'll always be
The MEAC Swag Challenge is proud to honor 2013 legend David Deacon Jones. Deacon Jones played defensive end for both the MEAC and SWAC conferences during his collegiate career. The Eatonville, Florida native played for South Carolina State as well as the formerly named Mississippi Vocational College, now Mississippi Valley State University. Jones was drafted in the 14th round of the 1961 NFL Draft by the Los Angeles Rams, where he became a member of the fearsome foursome defensive line. Nicknamed the Secretary of Defense, Jones specialized in quarterback sacks, a term which he coined. The 8-time Pro Bowl selectee rounded out his career with the San Diego Chargers and Washington Redskins before being inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 1980. In 2009, his number 75 jersey was retired by the St. Louis Rams. Recently, the NFL honored the Gale Sayers Lifetime Spirit Achievement Award winner with an award of his own, the Deacon Jones Award, created to annually recognize the league leader in sacks. Remaining true to his commitment to giving back, Jones dedicated much of his life after retiring from the gridiron to helping others through the Deacon Jones Foundation until his passing earlier this year.
Everybody out there in Radio Land, Joey Ciccone back with The Way It Used to Be. My new good friend. You know, I always got good friends, man. I'm always trying to find them out there, okay? Elizabeth Jones, man, the lovely wife of the famous Deacon Jones. We're going to keep it light a little bit, and then we're going to get into some heavier stuff when we talk about stuff. But, you know, I'd like to ask you a few things, if it's all right. You know, if you want to plead the fifth, we
go
totally
for
understand.
It.
You know what I'm saying?
I know how to talk and say nothing.
Well, let me tell you something. We're at an event. The lady got up on the mic. I was sitting there watching her, and I'm like, she knows how to talk. It's beautiful. This is great. And she knows how to handle herself because you're a very classy lady. We know Deacon had a very long list of accomplishments and accolades. We've known that. What modified him while he was playing in the NFL, I kind of know what, not modified, excuse me, what motivated him, I guess, is what I'm saying, motivated him while he was playing. Now, I've watched a lot of different footage, and I kind of know that answer, but coming from you and for our viewers and the people on the radio today, you know,
nothing modified him at all, Joey.
That's called sarcasm,
no,
folks.
No, I didn't mean it sarcastically.
No,
I meant it legitimately.
Right.
But what motivated him was hatred and anger and the lack of being able to accept that he was considered less than other human beings. He grew up, he was born in 1938 in Central Florida.
That's right.
And he came from the oldest black incorporated community in Central Florida, just outside of Orlando, where he grew up with a very strong family, but in not only in poverty, but in a community where everything was, you can't do this, you can't do that, you're crazy if you think you can succeed here.
That's
Stop
right.
dreaming, don't upset the white people around here, stay in line.
That's
and
exactly
that's what
right.
motivated him, my love.
That's right, darling. It's so from the heart. I get a little emotional because today, today we talk about Joey Ciccone tells it the way it is. So we talk about racial divides and different things, and we're gonna cover a lot of things like that. But hearing it from you is just a wonderful thing because obviously I never got to meet him except to watch him on the field and see what he did. And on the interview, you know, I saw that you know, Deacon would say, you know, in a very positive way, he had to take that. We all have frustration and things in life, okay? But he did it on the field, and he took business on putting those dudes down. And if I may say, once I put you down, I ain't reaching my hand down to pick you up.
Oh, never happened. Never.
Do you
happen.
Love it? Do you love it?
In fact, he used to get crazy when he saw people doing that. As far as he was concerned, they were expending energy. They didn't have to expend. You know, I laid you out. You get up your damn self.
Right. So
oh,
it wouldn't be this. Look, it wasn't this. Like, let me help
Not
you up.
Not in this lifetime.
Let me help you up after I gave you a little smack down.
He more than once, his friends would tell stories about how he went crazy in the locker room after a game because one of his partners, one of his co-players, did something like that. He'd just lose it.
Yeah. He had the heart, you know, I call it the heart of a lion, but on the field, and we're talking on the field right now, and I'm sorry, friends, but it's gone because I want to make a famous quote, and I don't want to quote one of my favorite coaches, Mike Ditka, at a line, but I do want to say, at one time, football was for the fun of the game and the love of the game. And now it seems to be for the love of the green. Okay? Things have changed. Okay?
If it's for the love of anything, you know, I really don't know. All I know is that it was Deacon's first love. And football was first in everything. It's the way he defined himself.
Right.
And fortunately, he had football to get out that anger, because God only knows where he would have wound up if he didn't have the ability to take it out legally
right.
on the field.
Exactly. And doing a lot of research and friends, just so you know, we deal with a lot of racial things. There was things here that I'm going to cover today and that are very important. It was a different time. It was a different place, as in my show, you know, the way it used to be, but things were different. And he felt, you know, a lot of pain from a lot of things that maybe weren't right. And personally, I do believe those things weren't right. That just happens to be my opinion and the way I was raised. But to overcome that and to step on the field and take care of business, and all these accolades and awards that were honored him, has to make you feel proud. I mean, has to, you know, that we know he's gone, he's in a better place, but the point is this, that's a legacy, man. I was with Miles Davis 17 years, okay? And I live with that every day. I know what he taught me and the different things he told me. Are you okay with the cord over there playing with it? You okay? Yeah. Definitely.
It's difficult to deal with. It's difficult to understand, Joey, when you're not raised like that yourself, you know, because you can never really understand the depth of the scars that it leaves on people. And Deacon died with big chips on both of his shoulders. They had gone away and mellowed out a lot over the years.
With that being said, I want to say that happened to be a little late because I was watching a clip, too, on top of it. Not to make excuses, but if I tell you, then you'd be like, Joey, you did watch that, and it's truly from the heart. When Rosie Greer is sitting with him and talking to
him.
In
my house.
It's in your house.
Yes.
Okay, and we're not going to reveal where that house is, but it's in Cali. I love Cali. But the bottom line is this. Rosie was trying to tell him, no, Deacon. Those are over. You don't have that. Because we know Rosie Greer as a preacher. And
well, you know Rosie Greer as a preacher.
Well, yeah, you know
him. I know Rosie you, as you my know him close as a, friend.
You know him as a whole thing and, yeah. as a, and as a close friend. But to put out the good vibe like that.
Yeah.
But in the interview, you could see that Deacon still lived with it, is what I saw.
It might not be correct. No,
but
you
I'm
are
just
correct. You are correct, and it was a constant conversation, but more of a constant joke between Rosie and Deacon all along. Because naturally, Deacon knew Rosie long before he was a minister, when he was kind
right.
of a big bad boy in L.A.
Yeah, because he was yeah.
Yeah,
and he was one too.
When Rosie wanted to marry Deacon and me. Deacon wouldn't have anything to do with it at all. He wanted us to be married by a real person, not by a fake minister.
Yeah, you come out to Vegas and, I don't know, maybe Frank Collada. Frank, maybe you could, you threw a wedding for him. I don't know. But,
I don't know. But Rosie was always trying to preach to Deacon about loving this one and loving that one and not caring that. I mean, it was a half-hearted attempt by Rosie, because he knew he wasn't going to get anywhere, and quite frankly, Deacon didn't want to hear about it anymore. So it was kind of a typical conversation we always had when they would get together, until Rosie would just drop the whole thing and realize he wasn't about to win.
And that was it. Yeah. That was like, yeah. You're not going to win, that's it, let's play poker or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah.
All right, so here's what I want to ask you. What do you think was your husband's greatest moment in his phenomenal career? And these are just questions that we're just throwing out. Of course, there's a lot. There's a ton to tell, but there's got to be one that maybe sticks out that, you know, the fans and the people out there want to know.
Well, what I think was his greatest moment is probably, what he thought was his greatest moment was induction into the Pro Football Hall of Fame by unanimous vote in his first year of eligibility.
It's got to be the most unbelievable feeling.
Yeah.
In the world.
And you know, because you sound very savvy about the Hall of Fame, you know, very few of the athletes have ever been inducted in their first year,
exactly.
Let alone by 100% of the vote.
100% of the vote was given
yes.
to him to be inducted. And what year would that have been?
1980.
That was 1980.
Yeah.
And then
naturally, I thought it was before my time, a couple of years, and I thought it was great, but I was really thrilled when he was named unanimously to the 75-year all-time team.
Right, what were you, like 22 at the time?
Me? Somewhere I was younger than that.
Oh, is he younger than that?
He robbed the cradle.
I just messed. I screwed up bad right now.
Yeah,
God.
Yeah.
I'm not winning today, but...
Not at all, but that's okay.
But see, folks, this is what I'm saying. When what I saw, a person getting up there on the mic at an event we were at for Vegas AllNet Radio, I saw her charm and the way she spoke, and it meant a lot to me for you to be here. But
thank you,
because you're sharp, you know.
But I will tell you Deacon's favorite game. I'm sure you want to hear that.
I want to hear. We want to hear everything. I don't just want to ask questions. I want you to tell we. People out there listening today, by the way, 702-483-4444, talk to Miss Jones.
Well, you wanted to know what I thought his greatest moment was, and I don't think he when people used to ask him that, he would answer all of them.
Right.
So he didn't
so
have
So he'd go through a list like...
No, he'd just say, they said, Deacon, what was your greatest play or your greatest moment on football field? And he'd say all of them.
Oh, that's fine. That's,
he didn't
that's
have
fine.
To go through a list.
He didn't have
all
to.
All is all, right?
It's all there, baby. One of Sarah's.
The game
Sarah's
that
there.
He liked so much was there was a game, an away game. I don't remember where it was. And he had the flu. And he had something like 104 fever, and he couldn't play. And George Allen was his coach.
Right.
And so the team got all dressed, and they left him suffering in the hotel room, and they got on the bus and they all went to the game, and he laid there for as long as he could stand it, and then he just said, the heck with this, I've got to go play. So he got up and he got a car and he went to the stadium, and he arrived and everybody was already ready to go out on the field, and he came into the locker room, and you know what kind of an inspiration that has to give your players when you show up. But he came in and everybody went out, everybody was in shock, and coach was, what are you doing here? I don't want you to be sick, you know.
Exactly.
Everybody goes out on the field.
We need you for the next few games and rest a little bit.
Well, he wanted to get right out on the field, so he didn't get taped, he didn't get anything, he just got dressed. And he ran out on the field, and he was player of the game. And
player of the game.
Yeah.
104 temperature.
And no pads, no nothing, no taping, no nothing. Just went out and he played, and he only played three quarters, and then they were winning by so much that he sat down for the fourth quarter. He won player of the game, and for the first time ever, when they got back on the plane to come home, George didn't like liquor at all. He wouldn't allow his boys to drink, and so Deacon got in the back of the plane sick as a dog, and George asked him what he could do for him, and he said, get somebody, go out here and get me a quart of bourbon. So George sent somebody.
Nice. That's what we do. It's good for the throat, friends.
Yeah. George sent somebody out to go get the bourbon.
Take care of business. A little hot, right. A little hot toddy. Never hurts anybody.
Yeah.
We see Deacon and your loveliness here. And I think I know this.
You think you know who he is?
That's Mr. Joe Namath, man. And I love him, man. I'll tell you right now. You're listening to the Joey Ciccone Show. I'm here with my dear friend, me and Mrs. Jones. Well, I don't want to continue with that, but we'll be right back right after.
Hey, everybody, you're here with Joey.
I want to say happy Friday. It's October, man. I love it. Pumpkin pie. Leaves. But then I thought I was back in Chicago for a minute, so
football. Forgot football.
Football. Oh, how could you forget football? Because that's the topic of the day. My man, Deacon Jones, and in the second hour, we bring in the Deacon Jones Foundation and what they do, and that's what that's all about. And that's all about love and heart and everything. And as you know, I mean, you know, I'm here with his lovely wife telling the stories we want to hear. You know, you watched him on the football field. We want to know stuff that happened maybe off the field a little bit, all right? Just off the hand, I just tell me about the Deacon Jones Foundation, the many great things your organization provides. Because I heard it at the event,
yeah.
But they want to hear it.
Well, because of Deacon's upbringing, the way he was brought up, and the circumstances under which he had to struggle to succeed. He was very important to him that other kids who came from disadvantaged areas,
yes,
have, I hate to say a level playing field, because I think the playing field is never leveled,
right,
when you go through that, but had as many advantages as they could possibly have, so that when they did go to college, they could be as equal to the other kids from Beverly Hills as
right.
was possible.
Exactly.
And so in 1997, we formed the Deacon Jones Foundation, and at that particular time, we were in Los Angeles, and we had a lot of very strong corporate friends, CEOs and presidents of major
sure.
corporations for whom Deacon had worked for years, you know, at corporate
sure.
imaging and special events and motivational speaking and so on. And so we put the foundation together. It's a 501c3 public charity.
We love that.
Yeah. Ooh. And we started raising enough money so that we could put kids into a situation where we gave them mentoring and internship with corporate clients and taught them about giving back to their own communities, guaranteed that they would have the money to go to school. And we had a 7-year program that was very extensive. And now, after Deacon passed away, I really didn't know what I was going to do with it. I came to Las Vegas and decided that we would take a different tack.
Well, the bottom line is that you're here with us today.
Yes.
And We are totally supportive to make that happen. Myself, my manager Helen there, that was at the event with me, we're 100% behind helping in any way. We do a lot of humanitarian work. We're going to be together, my dear. We're going to go into our second hour right now. I want to lay a tune on you that I wrote. I think it was like in the 80s somewhere. The tune is called Sign. And the reason I put this in there, it's like a sign. It's like about a guy with his kid and what he's telling the kid. And it kind of related with Deacon and the whole story, which I'm going to be bringing up and everything. Joey Ciccone here with you. The way it used to be. The tune, Sign. Check it out. Everybody, it's Joey. How y'all doing? The way it used to be. Maybe I change it right now to the way it is, too, okay? It's so happy to be Well, I'm so happy to be here with you. So excited. Ran a little late from some accidents. I hope you're all listening. Remember, our call-in number is 702-483-4444. We're at the top of the hour, 5 o'clock. I'll be here till 6. My special guest today, Elizabeth Jones, the widow of the famous Deacon Jones. Hits me hard. But we're going to talk about a little things. I want to break a little ice. I didn't get to do my opening this morning. What am I, just waking up? It was this afternoon. But want to say hi to everybody out there in Radio Land, Los Angeles, all my good friends here in Vegas, Facebook friends, Vietnam, Germany, everyone that's been following me. A lot of love out there. We got a lot of big events coming up here for you, which I'm going to give you some dates. I'm going to be doing some touring that's going to be overseas coming up, and looks like a book deal is going to be happening, and just wanted to touch on some of those thoughts. But what I wanted to talk about too is some just crazy stuff that's been happening. But you know, I always like to touch on the news a little bit. Sorry, had to get some water out there. Something very dear to my heart, you know. Oregon or whatever, the alleged gunman who opened fire at a community college on Thursday, killing at least 9 and wounding 7 before being shot dead by police, was armed with 6 firearms and a flak jacket during the attack, authorities said on Friday. I don't even want to mention the guy's name, but the Chris Harper Mercer. I wanted to mention a few things, you know, and it's from the heart, you know, like I always speak. This is not a racial show, and I would never even cross that boundaries, because, you know, I believe that we're from all different ethnicities and colors and everything, and there's good and bad on each sides. But this is my little take on it. You know, you have the white guy that's you know, he's out there doing the shooting in the theaters and everything else. And, you know, why? Because he's a student and he's young and, you know, mommy and daddy gave him the money and he's got the meds that he needs. And, you know, we don't hear about that, right? We hear about, you know, our African-American brothers and all the things they do. But I don't see anybody stepping into theaters, killing people, stepping into colleges and doing stuff like that. And so I kind of wanted to just get that across and talk to you on a spiritual note, which I kind of cover all bases, from entertainment to everything. From you've seen my show, but I mean, I'm talking to you like a friend would talk to a friend. You never hear that part of it, but we always hear, you know, the African American man, the colored skinned man, the brown skinned man, okay, doing these things. But in the meantime, you know, here's a guy again. We had the guy at the in Colorado doing things, and you know, it's news that makes me. It hurts when I hear it. You know, 6 weapons were found at the scene of the shooting. I'm just kind of just passing through it, but it was news to me, and it bothered me, man. You know, innocent people died, you know, and you know, this guy's 26 years old, a shy young man who formerly lived in California, and according to some witnesses, may have targeted some of the victims due to their religion. Okay, so I'll tell you right now, if it's religion, color, whatever it is, man, we bottom line is we need love, man. It's about love. It's about treating people, you know, the way you want to be treated. And that's my take on that part. I did want to bring that up because we're talking about Deacon today, and what he stood for and what he believed in. And you know, he might have had a lot of pain in his heart to show that on the field I have to let out my anger there instead of racially letting out my anger. And I wanted to share that with you, and I hope that you liked that part that I brought up, because it was very sincere. On a fun note, On a little fun note, gotta have the shades on, so, you know, here's some stuff that just kills me, man, that I just had to bring up, but, you know, 10 wild facts that you don't know about in Las Vegas. And when I was looking through them, it was kind of, you know, Lawrence, it's kind of funny stuff, but, you know, but it's good to talk about. Drinking in public, you know, we all do it, but there's a little bit more to it. It says here, in basically every movie featuring Las Vegas, there is copious amount of drinking while in public. But that is just a liberty taken in the movies, or can you actually live the dream and wander around with a drink in your hand? Well, the bottom line is you can. It's Vegas. But here's the thing. Can't be a metal or glass container, no beer cans. And I love this part that I had to make a very big note on. And watch where you wander with your drink. Since you have it within 1,000 feet of a school, place or worship or hospital, you'll be risking an unplanned tour of the Clark County Detention Center. Okay, so yeah, get your groove on. Don't be like wandering around like a crazy person. That's the number 10. Number 9, I'm going to hit you real fast with them, okay? Prostitution, all right, is not legal in Las Vegas. Maybe you didn't know, all right? Okay, all right. You think maybe yes, it is, but, well, yes, it is in some areas, okay? And I love this one because outer limits, for better or worse, is being the only state that permits legal prostitution. Well, actually, prostitution is not legal in Las Vegas, but it is in some of the outside areas. Right, Lawrence? We know that, right? Well, he doesn't know it, but, you know, we know it. I want to move along because I want to get the girls back out here. This one I love, man. This one I love. You ever hear of Janet Airlines? Oh, you're going to love this. You're going to love this. This is great. It's classic. Let me just get a little sip. Janet Airlines. Listen to this real quick. Nevada is home of America's most secretive military facilities, the classified base known as Area 51. I'm going to just skip the whole paragraph and basically tell you what goes on. Janet Airlines is a secret airlines that takes the people that commute from Las Vegas out to Area 51. For them to drive out there, it's 8 hours. This has a whole, if you see white airplanes at McCarran that's taken off from a certain area, they're going to Area 51 to work. They come back. This has been released about a year ago, but you didn't know that. That's things you didn't know. See? All right. Don't you love it? All right. Who was this one? For my buddy Mike Steele. Mike, throwing this out at you today, okay? Over in your area over there in Boulder. You can't gamble over there in Boulder City, all right? You can't do that. And there's reasonings behind it, but gambling capital of the world, we know that, Las Vegas. But over there when they had, let me just tell you real quick, when they had the guys working on the Lake Mead and everything, they didn't want them going there blowing their check and doing that whole thing. And they actually banned it, and till this day it still goes on, okay? Just some fun things. Howard Hughes, I talked about this. He stayed at the Desert Inn. They told him, you got to go now. You've been at the Desert Inn forever. You know, you're staying here, you're staying here. I don't have to go anywhere. He buys the place. All right? Just some funny thoughts, man. But I'll just leave you with this one real fast here. The Black Book. I love it. You see me with John Alight. I've been with Collada. I've been with these guys. I don't know if I'm in the Black Book, but the Black Book does exist. But actually, now I found out, it's a gray binder. Okay? And if your name's in it, you're going to be in trouble, all right? I got a song coming up for you. I'm going to have my beautiful guest coming up. Can you give me one sec right here? The number one thing you didn't know about Vegas, the Mississippi of the West, okay? And basically, we're talking about racial things. Most people today don't associate with Jim Crow the series of laws mandating segregation that came about after the end of Reconstruction. The bottom line is what I want to say here is this was known as the Mississippi of the West. and blacks, African Americans, had to live in certain areas, D Street, F Street. I don't like this. I don't like it. I don't like the way it went done. I'm going to lay one of my tunes on you. I'm going to bring back my lovely guest, Elizabeth Jones, and we're going to get into talking about some racial things and the way football and life and everything's turned around. Joey Ciccone with you. I'll be right back.
Thank you. Who be you?
Hollywood believes in typecasting.
I am looking for a little girl about so high. I'm her mother.
Named Tabitha?
Yes, yes.
You would pay for her no-nos.
What did she do?
You should be ashamed to raise such a wicked little girl.
Deacon Jones was the big bad guy. Rowan Olson starred in wholesome shows like Little House on the Prairie and Father Murphy. Deacon pitched beer and threatened you in the process.
And if you don't believe me, I'm going to break your nose.
Merlin sold flowers. Deacon once appeared in an episode of The Odd Couple. But truth be told, Felix and Oscar had a lot more in common than Deacon and Merlin.
Lamar used to tell me all the time, "Hey, baby, I don't know how they ever played together. Those two, God only knows how they could have played together on the same team."
They lined up next to each other for 10 years. Merlin was the 1962 Rookie of the Year and went to a record 14 straight Pro Bowls. Deacon was a two-time Defensive Player of the Year and earned 8 Pro Bowl honors. They both ended up in the Hall of Fame, but about the only thing they had in common was a difficult path to the NFL.
I always wanted to be an athlete. That was a desire I carried from a very young age.
When he got cut from the ninth grade basketball team, the coach said, "Listen, Merlin," he said, "I hear you're pretty good with the books." He said, "You need to give this sports thing up. You're never going to be an athlete."
"Our job here at the junior high school is to develop athletes for the high school, and you're never going to be an athlete. Just, you know, let it go."
When Merlin used to tell that story, the veins in his neck would bulge.
Merlin went on to star at Utah State, where he won the Outland Trophy as the country's best interior lineman. But the Phi Beta Kappa member never forgot the lesson he learned in junior high.
That coach was trying to take something from him that he wanted so much. Don't let anyone steal your dream.
Merlin was told he wasn't good enough. Growing up in Florida, Deacon often was told he wasn't allowed.
"I didn't just hear about riding on the back of the bus. I rode on the back of the bus. I was put in jail for trying to sit down and eat a meal. I almost got hung myself down there when I was in school.
I stood in front of that water hose. I remember the denials and all the nasty comments. I never went to school with a Caucasian guy. The first one I hit without the police coming after me was in the pros.
Hell, I don't like holding that grudge. I really wish I could dump it, you know? But I lived it. I got too much hate in me."
"You don't have hate in you.
I got it.
You saying you confessing that you have hate. And though you confess it, you have it.
I got a ton of it. Yeah.
You can let all that go."
"No, I can't let it go."
I think that it was quite fortunate that he had football to let that aggression and that anger out.
"I got a chance to get down in there in the pit, and I got a chance to hit something. And the harder I hit, the more I released those hostilities."
Deacon focused his rage on the quarterback. He even invented a term for tackling the passer behind the line of scrimmage.
"Sacking the quarterback is just like you devastate a city, or you cream a multitude of people. I mean, it's just like you put all the offensive players in one bag and I just take a baseball bat and beat on the bag."
"You have to dislike the position. It's not the guys so much. I mean, there's tons of quarterbacks who are really good friends of ours."
"They talk about Fran Tarkenton.
More heroics by Tarkenton.
We chased Fran that son of a gun so much that it wasn't even funny."
He eludes Dave Jones, locates Brown at the goal line, fires, and it's another Minnesota touchdown.
I mean, we hated him. We actually hated this.
Did you hate him, Rosie?"
"Oh, let me, I got to, we're playing."
"Rosie, I don't see any hate in you. Did you hate him?"
"No, not really. I mean, he doesn't really mean that.
Vince Ferragamo is down the street. He's a really good friend of ours. Roman Gabriel, of course, has been a friend for years."
"Which one do you hate the most?"
"All quarterbacks. I don't give a damn who they are. I hate Roman Gabriel. He's on my team."
"Deacon would say, 'Get out of my way. I'm going to kill you.
I'm going to kill that mother tonight.
Bob Blanchard.
You what?
Merlin, after he knocked you down, he'd help you get up. Deacon would want to step on you.
I ain't helping you up off the ground. I'm gonna step on your hand.
I've dealt with players and played with players who felt that they can only play when they hated the guy across the line. And I thought, boy, that's tragic. I mean,
some of my very closest friends around the league are the guys that I play right opposite. We actually develop a very strong attachment.
When I told everyone I was coming to interview Merlin Olsen, they said, Phyllis, you've never met a nicer guy. How do you maintain this congenial attitude you have?
Well, I think it's possible to separate the game on the field from the person off the field. I'm not a violent person by nature. I really detest violence in many ways. But my job requires that I do certain things. I made some commitments to doing that job as well as I possibly could. And I'm willing to crunch quarterbacks.
What do you think it was about football that most appealed to him?
The complexity of it. It wasn't a physical game for Merlin. It was more of an intellectual game.
We can either fire him up.
To me, the mental side of football and the emotional side of the game is even more challenging than the physical side of the game.
All of you just come on over a little bit.
Socrates must have had him in mind, or the Greeks did, because he was the sound mind in a sound body. God doesn't create them perfectly, but he came real close with Merlin Olsen.
Was there anything as a player that he didn't do well or that might have been a pain at a time and not always the good guy? Can you think of anything?
No.
I found it very difficult to sit here and listen to the nice things that were said about me because I keep wanting to say
The entire history of football, if you're going to vote for the best defensive tackle ever, you've got to consider Merlin Olsen as the guy.
And any discussion of the best defensive end has to include the man who, along with Merlin, formed football's odd couple.
The strengths of Merlin Olsen made Deacon Jones much better. The quality of the pass rush high and outside by Deacon Jones made Merlin Olsen better because he'd force them to step up and they couldn't step up. Why? Because Merlin Olsen was there.
Even though they had a lot of different ways of looking at the game, they could just almost read each other's minds, I think.
We were perfect together, perfect marriage.
Ciccone Beck. We are with I'm just having so much fun. We are with Elizabeth Jones, the lovely, I have to say this, the lovely widow of Deacon Jones. And Ellen, beautiful sister, is here too, sitting in with us. Got my manager here in the studio. We're having a great Friday. I hope you are. And I got a lot to cover in this next little transition, but I was just thinking of something kind of funny. So, like, I thought Helen, you know me very well, right? So, like, if I was a quarterback, you know, and, like, Deacon knocked my ass down, you know, I'd be like, hi, how you doing? Can you give me a lift up? And he'd be like,
no, you wouldn't.
You ain't getting a lift up.
No, you can't be passed
out. What are you trying to say? What are you trying to say? I work out every day. What are you trying to say? I know, he knocked me good. I was I had like a concussion, but then I was like, can you help me up?
You know, our friend Tarkington got inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame, and we were there.
Wait, I love this. Tell us about it. I got to hear this.
Yeah, we were there, and Deacon's sitting behind him on the dais, and Fran says, you know, they really credit me with being the greatest scrambler ever. And then he turns around and he said, you see Deacon Jones back here? You'd learn how to scramble awful fast, too.
Right?
Yeah.
Right? You better believe. And from the footage I saw, you know, obviously I was a young boy watching that, but there was a lot of scrambling going on, man.
A lot.
Let me get away from this dude. And then he was not, he wouldn't stop. He'd just keep coming and coming and coming. Anyway, you saw that beautiful footage, my friends, at the beginning there, and the first show was a little bit on the lighter side, and now with Elizabeth, I want to talk about some things that are a little bit more serious. You know, I like to be fun, but I also like to be serious, and you know, the racial part plays a part in things. As he was growing up, and you know, in Florida and stuff, we talked about that, and he had to deal with a lot coming up to try to be successful. In a time that is trying to keep a man down is a different thing. And if you can do that, man, I love that. I mean, that's the Rocky in me, you know. That's the Sylvester Stallone, and that's a guy that, you know, I respect very much, your husband. And
thank you.
And I guess my point would be, talking about those racial times, I want to touch on them. Okay,
you know. Sure.
I don't know if it's Mike Ditka. I don't want to re-quote it, but I did say it earlier. And, you know, football was fun and everything, and now it's for the money. Things have changed a lot from how it used to be. Guys played it, you know, for the fun of the game. Obviously, they had to get paid and do things. A lot of guys played hurt. You heard the story Elizabeth said. Deacon sitting there with 104 temperature in a hotel room, and it's like, you know, you ain't going to keep the man down. You don't keep a good man down. And that's what happened. Let me ask you this one. You were asked how Deacon would appreciate the event, held 2 years ago, September, for the Hall of Famers event in his hometown. Okay, so now you're going back to your hometown, man, where you don't need to prove anything, okay?
But you do. You do, well, because your hometown is the same town that told you you couldn't succeed.
Right.
You know, he hated that place.
Right. Right, but I know, but you, like, you went back there, and yeah, you do have to prove something, because I got to be a little Italian right now. You got to stick it, baby. You
got to
show it the way it is, baby,
yeah,
right
in
now.
Your face.
Just a little gift for you. Remember, I just wanted to say, it's Joey Ciccone. There's a lot more coming. That's your little stick, okay? All right, this is a great honor, and I know Deacon would appreciate this event. What does this ceremony mean to you to honor Deacon's legacy?
Deacon would not have appreciated this event at all. This is not the first time he was honored in his hometown. He was made Grand Marshal of the Centennial Parade, and at the end of the parade, the Klan was flying their balloons over the parade.
You see what I'm saying?
He was not happy. He hated that place. The only time we ever went back there was to see his mother, who still lived there, and that was only when there was a Super Bowl in Tampa that we went back there. He had a street named after him. He had all the accolades in the world back there. And it would have meant absolutely, positively nothing to him to go back there.
So
as far as my going back there, I felt obviously the same way about a place that gave him such a bitter taste in his mouth for his entire life. I went back there because I felt obligated to do it. It was for the hall. It was a tribute to my husband. But as far as meaning to me to go back there, I couldn't wait to get out of there after the event.
Right. So the bottom line is that the stigma of that stayed with him. Let's put the cards on the table. We're not going to say that it disappeared.
No, it stayed with him forever. He hated that place.
And everything became, you know, and what he went through and everything else. Because you come up hard, and you're a success, you've done well, and then you go back, and, you know, I just remember the line, I'm just going back to the line where, that I remember him saying that, I don't want to come up like that, I don't want to see my people, whether it's race or what, I don't want to see my people have to go through that. And he was a success, but he still felt the pain in all that, you know what I'm saying?
He hated it. He couldn't stand it. I mean, but more than that, he couldn't stand the attitude of the people down there.
What a lovely.
What a beautiful couple, aren't we cute?
Very cute. I love the picture. I love all.
That was at one of the Deacon Jones Foundation's golf tournaments at La Costa.
Oh, and that's a beautiful course. Sometimes I hit the ball and it goes like that. Listen, it's Joey Ciccone, the way it used to be. My beautiful guest. What more can I say? I gotta take a break. We gotta pay some bills. I'll be right back. Las Vegas, Joey Ciccone here with you. The way it used to be. My special guest today, Elizabeth Jones and her lovely sister hiding off camera, feeding me my water. It's lovely. Try to give me the better alkaline water next time if you could.
Yeah,
these are jokes,
water,
honey.
Right?
I'm gonna ask you some questions. It's gonna be what do you call it, a question and answer period, real quick, but throw a few at you. What do you think Deacon would feel about the violence going on today between police and the people of color?
You'd think it was business as usual.
That's what I would have figured your answer would be.
Business as usual. He wouldn't be surprised.
May I say something? I think I might, because, you know, I think I can say this. I'm a man of color, being Italian or whether we're Latin or whatever it might be. I have felt, you know, the racial profiling that goes on there. So I don't think you know it until you feel it. And not that I'm trying to get political or anything. I'm just speaking from the heart.
You are, but, you know, I do need to say this to you, Joey.
Please.
After having been in Italy many, many times and pretty much living there over...
I've never even been there, and she's been
about 6 or 7 or 8 years, you need to understand that Sicilians are not considered Italians. They're considered from North Africa.
Hey, well, you know what?
I want you to understand that.
Well, but... I love you to death, but I want to make this clear. My closest friends, and my one closest friend was Miles Davis for 17 years.
Oh, there you go.
And so my closest friends are African American friends that we have a bond and we have something that is in our blood.
Well, the Northern Italians kind of want to divorce themselves from Sicilians, you know, so that's why they place you in a different continent altogether.
Yeah, well, the blood mix, things happen, and I got the best of both worlds, you know.
You do.
I got a wonderful voice, and I'll hold off on the other part right now, if you know what I mean, folks. Oh, okay. All right. Do you think we have become a nation of haves or have-nots? Things I'm throwing at you.
I don't think we've ever been anything but that, have we?
Have things changed? Where are we? We see what goes on. I love this, what my friend said. We were at the gym working out, and he's like, and he's an African-American, he's my workout partner. Snoop, little shout out to you, 702-483-4444. He's like, Joe, bottom line is it's been going on, you know, things haven't changed. It's been, you know, we see all the stuff that's in the news that's been happening, and I learned a lot of things from him, but, you know, like I said, is it haves or have-nots? It's still going, things are still going on. Where are we is what I'm trying to get at.
The difference is 24/7 news, Joey.
Ah, that's where okay, good. You're good. So sharp.
You know, we didn't hear about it day in and day out before.
That's what I was trying to get at, but then I didn't take, what's the little pill for your memory? All right, whatever,
you don't want
it matters.
To say that on air.
I remember him saying this, Joe, you didn't hear about Nancy Grace and all the things that happened with kids and all these cycles and everything else, or the killings or this or that. You're so right. Was it going on?
Yeah, of course. I mean,
it was going on, but we didn't hear about it every day like we hear about it.
Every day. All day long.
All day long.
Every station. Come on.
I mean, come on. So, and I remember when he brought that up to me, that was like very, it really hit me, because it's been going on. It's just that we didn't hear about it all the time. Now, even though my show is the way things used to be, it's the way things are now. They talk about everything. Every 2 minutes you turn the TV on and we got to hear about this, that. What's happened here with the shootings, with the police, this, that, you know, it's crazy. But I want to get to, bottom line is we need to talk foundation, we need to talk positiveness, we need to talk about the love. If your husband ran for a public office, which, I love it, I got to find good questions. Let me finish. Which government office would he have made an impact today?
And when I saw that, you know, I can imagine that you forgot he's already Secretary of Defense.
I didn't know that. The Secretary. Yeah. Did I wake up late today?
Yeah, really. You must have. Yeah, because when I read that, you know, I went, I can't believe this. He's been Secretary of Defense since 1962.
She's gonna steal my show, man. She.
I should have had the great comeback, right?
Because that's what he was, the Secretary of Defense, the SAC man.
And everybody named him that. L.A. Times named him that. The League.
I've seen it.
Yeah, and you want to give him another title now, right?
No.
Okay, good.
I ain't messing at all with him. I love him from the heart, all right? Was it a difficult time being married in early decades before civil rights were put in place? And I mean, how did you handle the obstacles?
You know, it's interesting that you asked that question, really, because Helen and I were just talking that I was born and raised in Los Angeles, and we just didn't have the kind of prejudice that existed in most other places in the country. We have we're Hollywood. I mean, we grew up Hollywood.
I love it.
Everybody was accepted.
I love
Everybody was equal. We didn't think about those things.
Right.
And my biggest problem with the racial differences were between me and Deacon, because he always wanted to stick my face in things I didn't see and make me look at it. And I'm more than once I was ready to pull my hair out and say, I'm crazy over you, I love you, but I can't take it anymore, because he saw prejudice in every corner, in everybody's actions, in everybody's remarks, in everything. And I didn't. I walked like, you know, wearing blinders. I didn't see anything
right
from side to side.
And let me ask you on a personal note. So obviously, you know, he shared, as husband and wife, he shared things with you, and hopefully you saw maybe what he saw. Did you see, I'm sorry, he saw things that you brought up, and he brought up things to you. Was it equal? Like, would he agree with you maybe sometime?
Or oh, he didn't agree with anybody. Please, you had to know how to talk.
I don't know.
To
That's
him.
What I'm saying. I don't know nothing. All I know is he's coming at me. Ah!
Yeah. No, he
get rid of the football.
He had his very strict opinions, but he, I think, honest to God, I'm probably the only person on the planet he did listen to, because I'm the only one he trusted.
Well, he loved his wife, and
And we had a special relationship. But yeah, the biggest prejudice that I found in our relationship, not only early on, but to this very day, and I hope I don't offend anybody by saying this,
you won't,
but black women hate my little guts.
Yeah, well, I have seen that through my lifetime and different things, and the world still ain't fixed. Let's just put it that way. I got a song for you that I wrote.
It was a shock to me.
Right? I got a song that's just beautiful. It's called Freedom. And we're going to play it for you right now. It's got a great lyric, and maybe we need some freedom out there, folks. You know what I'm saying? Joey Ciccone, I'll be right back with you.
Freedom!
Everybody, Joey Ciccone with you. Where's the El Dorado? I hope it's safe out there the way it used to be, or our new thing, the way it is, man, the way it is now, okay? My lovely guest, Elizabeth Jones. What a character. You got to love her. It's so beautiful. I'm getting right into it. We're going to be tying things up here for the closer to 6 o'clock hour. Got my manager and my producer sitting in, Helen. She's always fun. And what a lovely, your sister, you brought her with, well, you live here, so, you know, it wasn't a big stretch. We're coming from Spanish Trails, yeah. Okay, here we go. We're getting right back into it.
Yes,
not
sir.
A lot of time.
Yes, sir.
And then you tell me all this stuff on the side, you know, all the secret stuff that nobody knows.
Yeah, I'll tell you all of that.
I get all the
secrets. You can't use my material when I'm gone.
I'm not going to use your material. If you need me to sign a check to say you can tell that joke or tell that story, then it's a different things. What was your childhood like? We want to know this in comparison to Deacon. Was it the difference or the commonality with each that brought you, you know, both together? What, there had to be something. You had to see something in him. I guess the bottom line is, what was your childhood like in comparison?
It was kismet between Deacon and me. But my childhood was completely different than Deacon's childhood. We were raised in a affluent white neighborhood in an area of Los Angeles that was very upscale, and we went to great schools, and we had everything that we ever wanted, and we were educated, and it was just total, completely different. You name it, and it was different. Different color, different religion, different environment, different socioeconomic position, different everything. So different everything.
I love it. What was the secret of your long-term marriage to such a public figure?
We were just the same. You know, our upbringing was different. Our background's totally different, but underneath it all, Deacon and I are the same person.
Okay, so there's a lot of, I don't mean to interrupt, but there's a lot of love, but you know, I'm a married guy. The bottom line is this. We all have beautiful times and everything. You had to fight. There had to be stuff sometimes.
I can't fight with somebody that's over twice my size and talks louder than I can.
You could, honey, if you had the 9mm I have. But anyway, that's another show.
No, there wasn't any. Listen, any time I raised my voice in our marriage, I stopped Deacon dead in his tracks because he didn't know where it was coming from.
Right. Okay. Yeah. But it all worked out in the end, right?
Yeah, and it's not the end.
It's never the end, because my manager, Helen, here, and she runs a 501, and I want to give her credit, because Eco Dream is, we do, the humanitarian work we've done, I've talked about it, you know. Sometimes I'm not very clear, you know. I might be a little jet-lagged from here and there, but the point of Matt is she does a wonderful job from San Francisco and everything. So I'd like Helen to talk to Ms. Jones and cover a few questions. We're going to tie up some loose ends because we don't have much time left. Joey Ciccone Show, every Friday, 4 to 6. Maybe we go 4 to 4 in the morning. I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what happens tomorrow. But Helen, you got the floor.
Great. Thank you very much.
Honey, Corey. Speak up. Jump up there.
Thank you very much. You know what I wanted to ask you is, like, I know when you run a nonprofit, it becomes part of your life.
Yeah.
It's like your blood. And you're now new to the area.
Correct.
What can we do to help?
Oh, I love that. What I need to do, Helen, now is, after Deacon passed away and I moved here, I really could no longer do the things that we did with the foundation when he was alive, and I needed to wrap my head around what to do, and ultimately I decided that fine art, NFL art, was a big tribute to my husband and a tribute to the game that was his life and that he loved so much, and to the league. And so I was able to secure a license from the National Football League for all of their trademarks.
Wow, that's fantastic.
Yeah, amazing. And a bunch of sports artists got in contact with me, and I did with them, and we're using the art that we have in limited edition fine art giclées on archival canvas. It's gorgeous, and we're using it as fundraisers for the Deacon Jones Foundation. And I would love to have people go to deaconjones.com, take a look at the art. I would love to, and I think we talked about it a few minutes on the break, I'd love to get together with you and other organizations and interface with you, maybe co-op events with you, offer our product for auction at your events with you, and make ourselves known in this community. We're doing our first program here at Mojave High School, where the Deacon Jones Foundation is sponsoring an after-school art program. Mm-hmm. And then out of that will come three scholarships for kids for higher education. So I think it's really important that we get on solid footing in the community where I now live and where the Deacon Jones Foundation is now domesticated, and it's now a Nevada corporation.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah. Okay, so you do have an office, or do you normally
it's
go?
My office right out of my house. Okay. We have no overhead, no salaries.
I know how that is.
Yeah, you got it. Everything goes to the kids.
Okay. Well, that's a great job that you're doing then.
Thank
we would
you.
Love to help you in any way that we can.
Right. Now I don't mean to interrupt, but I love when the ladies talk. They just, you know, it's fantastic. They're going to go. Got a few minutes left in the show. I don't want it to end right now, to be honest with you, but our company is the Green Cat Ventures. What does the Green Cat Ventures cover? Everything, man. Books, movies, all my music, everything. But it's not about me. It's about who I bring on here and what we can do to help each other make the world a better place. You know, it's all about love, man. Show a little love out there, people. That's what you need to do. Say hi to a friend you never said hi to. You know, do a favor for someone. You know, it's a good thing, you know. I want to tell you I had a fantastic, fantastic Friday. Coming off of it a little bit, you know, we did a little sports touch over here. Why? Because I was at an event and I met Miss Elizabeth Jones. Deacon, rest in peace. I was a fan. I respect you, sir, and your wife. We will be doing everything to help your organization, Elizabeth, along with Helen and your lovely sister that's been flirting with me the whole time. I have to close with 30 seconds of a few things. This Saturday night, I will be at
Artifice.
I apologize. Oh. Artifice is a club right over here where we're doing the vintage closet for my girls, for the show girls that were here. Remember the pinup girls? So I'm going to be there signing my CD, signing my pictures. We're going to be doing all that. That's Saturday night about 6 o'clock. Okay. Next week's guest, let me just tag it for you real quick. A friend of ours, Fred Benzi, French superstar, gifted musician. All right. And his lovely wife, Fakuko. She's a designer. You're watching the Joey Ciccone Show, the way it used to be. Old Vegas, baby. Don't let me bring back the wise guys. I'll see you next Friday.